All right, class. So today we're going to learn about search and recovery. So the objective of this class is to make sure you do at least of an environmental impact as you can. You have all the equipment needed for the search and recovery. You know your search patterns, rigging as far as how to rig up different lift bags, using rope properly. Any challenges that you may encounter, the physics of lifting, and a recovery methods. Does anybody know why search and recovery is a cool class to take, in my opinion, at least?
Because you can find, artifacts?
You can find You can find a lot of things down there. There's a lot you can do with it. Like in my commercial days, we would come across boats and have to recover them, and I always just found it to be a lot real exciting. So let's get started. We're going to start on environmental impact. When you are doing the recovery, you want to make sure you're not destroying the environment just to pick up whatever you want to take home or whatever is down there that you're recovering. When you're anchoring the boat, try not to be near coral reefs in case the current takes the anchor or drags the boat. And you don't want to affect any artificial reefs. This could be anything from sunken ships, broken piers, anything that's been placed down there that has turned into an artificial reef. And it's very important. You want to make sure that you're allowed to recover whatever object it is. If it's a boat, you need the owner's permission to do so. If you are taking a piece of a wreck or something like that, you want to make sure you're allowed to, that it's not a public wreck and you don't want to take away something that other people are looking to see. So there's a few terminologies that I'm going to be using. A line, it's just a piece of rope, it's that simple. Swim cycles, this is a unit of measurement. Typically it's just two kicks, one with each foot if you're doing regular. Regular swim, or it'd be two kicks if you're doing frog. Different forms of rigging, depending on what you're using, how you're tying it up. It could be anything from rope to cables to slings to chains to using a hoist. And it's pretty much just to tie an object either to the lift bags or you're tying something to the boat. And then anchor points. It's basically, if you're doing a search, it'll be the anchor point. It's just a stead point that's not going to move, like an anchor on a boat. It anchors the boat to where it is. All good?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So, equipment. For lifting equipment, depending on what kind of lift method you're using, which we'll be going over later in the PowerPoint, is what you're going to need. But the three main things that for each method. Lift bags, if you're going to be using them, an air compressor, if you're not going to be using cylinders, if you're going to be displacing the air, and a trash pump. It's basically a giant pump that just shoots water in or takes water out. For search equipment, there are more advanced ways of doing it. They got side scan sonar, multi-view sonar, ROVs, scooters. For the purpose of this, for recreational, we're just going to stick with search lines. And it's just rope, basically it's a rope view that you use for searching. And then rigging equipment. More lines, slings, chains, cables, and hoists, like I said earlier. So the anchor point. Where you're anchoring the boat, you don't want to be near any coral reefs, anything that you may end up impacting the environment. And you have to be aware of how far you are from the object that you're trying to recover, how far the swim's going to have to be, how deep you're going, and then the anchor points on the object itself, which are where you're actually going to be tying the object off to the lift bag. So on the object itself, you just want to make sure that your anchor point is strong enough to hold the lift to bring it up.
Is that whose stomach is growling?
That's me. Oh, should have had that pizza earlier.
Oh man, that's loud.
Mm-hmm.
All
right. Sorry guys.
That's my distraction.
That was serious.
What's a lift bag?
Oh, good question. Why do you need a lift bag?
Well, sir, I don't know your name because
so,
you didn't
mention
it, but what's your name?
I am Craig Cooper. And we actually have a lift bag here. It's also further on in the slides. So I'll go over it a little further on the slides, but just to show you, this is a lift bag. We usually keep them folded up. When you don't fold it, it's just a giant bag to fill up with air. Alright?
For what?
So that you have a proper lift to bring whatever object you are recovering back up to the surface.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So, search patterns. There are a couple of different kinds of search patterns. These are the ones that we're going to go over. There's the circular search pattern, drag line, square, grid, running jack, and semicircle. So starting off with the first one, we have the circular search pattern. Got a picture here. You can either do it expanding or in a shrinking circle. But the premise of it is that you have the one anchor point, which is the red dot, and then you have the line attached to you, the diver. And if you were, say, expanding the circle, you start with 3 feet away and then do a full 360s. You can always look at your compass, be like, all right, I'm facing north right now. Do a full circle around while keeping the line taut. Once you're at the same heading, you'll let out another 5 feet to where the diver is. You'll do another 360, let out another 5 feet until you found whatever object you're looking for. If you don't find your object, then you have to keep expanding or go to a different spot and repost on your anchor point. Another method is the drag pattern. This will only work though if your object is actually standing up out of the water. It's more used for larger areas. So you need two divers for it. And basically they're attached by a line and they'll drag it right above the bottom, and when it gets snagged on something, it catches and you'll have better, it'll hopefully catch on the object you're looking for and you'll be able to find it easier just by following the line back. The downside with this is you do need two people to do it and a rather large line, and that's hoping that your object is standing out of the off of the bottom enough to catch the line. So then there's the expanding square pattern. So this one's a little bit trickier. You have to be a little better with the compass, but you'll start off going north and you measure your distance by kick cycle. So it'll be one kick cycle and you'll turn 90 degrees, look at your compass, make sure you're at it. Do two kick cycles, turn 90 degrees.
Why would I do this when I can just do the circle?
It's all in personal preference. This one, it's better if you don't, say if you don't have a piece of line with you, all right? Or if you're doing a bigger area or looking for a bigger object, this allows you just to keep moving and expand out quicker than with the circle. Okay?
Have you ever done this?
I have. This isn't my favorite method of searching, but I have done it and it does work.
For what? Searching for what?
When I did it, I was searching for a lost computer that was fell on the bottom.
Oh.
They knew a rough area.
Like
a laptop? Dive computer.
Oh,
sorry.
Okay.
Dive computer fell off fellow diver's wrist. We were looking for, we had a rough area to start with, and we just expanded out, and it was me and my buddy, and we just stayed next to each other the whole time, so we had two sets of eyes.
And you found it?
Yep, we ended up finding it, and it was about 20 feet from where
good.
He thought he dropped it. Another one is called the running jack. You can do this with one or two people, but to do this, you have to have two posts, anchor points, anything that will just stay into the ground, stakes. And basically you just make a straight line, and you'll start off from well past, like say well north of where the object is, and work your way down, moving the stakes 1 or 2 feet at a time, and keeping your eyes on the ground, and keep going downward. This is a little more time consuming. It's better if you have two people, so you have two eyes looking. Excuse me, miss, can you please stop playing with the dog?
Sorry about that.
Alright. Trying to stay focused on the lecture.
I don't really understand exactly what's going on right here. It looks like there are four anchor points around this side. Two letters.
So the four red dots are just to indicate the square area of your search. And when you do the running jack, you'll start at the top and you'll swim the line, didn't find it, move each stake downward, say a couple of feet, you'll swim the line back and forth, move it down again. So this is showing the divers that have already swam down a couple of different lengths. Okay? And with this, you don't have to worry about counting kick cycles. It is a little more time consuming. Grip pattern. I actually don't have a picture of this.
Why not?
I couldn't find a good picture.
Oh.
That's
too bad.
So, the grid pattern, it's basically just that. You make a grid, like on graph paper, and...
What's graph paper?
Graph paper is paper used in mathematics.
Is that the one with all the little boxes?
Yep.
Oh.
And you'll basically just go little box to little box, searching it. This way you're... It's, you have a large area, you'll search with smaller increments at a time. Miss, can you please put the phone away?
I'm trying to find a picture for you.
Sorry.
Craig? Is it Craig?
It is Craig. Semicircle. This is one of my favorite ones. It's a lot quicker.
Mm-hmm. Clearly the other one wasn't your favorite because you don't have a picture of it.
Yeah, it wasn't. I'm sorry. So it's one person can do it. It's just requires a line and an anchor point. It's the semicircle. Some people call it the pendulum. So you have your one anchor point, and you'll start off with just holding the string taut, holding the line taut, and...
Taut?
Taut. No slack in the line, so it's tight.
Oh, okay.
Taut?
Yes.
New Jersey taut?
And you'll basically swim from one side to the other. Like if you're at a wall, you can use the anchor point, and then when you hit one side of the wall, let out a couple of feet, and you'll swim back to the other side. If there's not a wall there, you can always use your compass, or just lay out a longer line so you know when you've hit the point.
How do you use a compass with a semicircle? Isn't that hard?
No, not too much, not really, because you'll just look at the compass, you'll realize your starting point, you're facing north, so if you pull out the compass at the end, you should be facing south. You should be facing a complete 180 off of what you started. So if you start facing north here, at the end of the line, you'll be facing south, and that's how you'll know when you need to let out some line to expand your pattern.
Okay, I got it now.
Alright. So, does anybody have any questions on different search patterns, different ways to find your object?
How does that grid work? Without a picture, I'm just trying to picture it.
Okay. If we go... You might not be able to see. If you come on up...
I can see
actually,
that. I can see
there is
work.
A slight grid
yeah.
to it.
So
that is how the grid pattern more or less would work. You start off with one little area, and you'll search this, and then move on to the next one.
Oh, so you actually do little circles.
Yep, you can do little circles, you can do little squares. It's just that you can use any other search pattern inside of the grid.
Oh, okay.
Except for however you want to search it.
That makes more sense then. Thank you for telling me.
Sorry, I know I
should've... What's behind the blue there? And swim what? It says, have a line with a post at each end, swim. What is that?
Have a line posted at each end and swim the length of the line.
Got it. Okay. Thanks.
So an important factor is safety. You want to make sure that the object you are recovering is clear to the surface. There aren't any boats. There aren't any lines tangled up. Excuse me, Lauren, can you please get off your phone again? Do I need to confiscate that from you?
Hard time having a teenager in class.
That the surface is going to be clear of any boat traffic. So if you are diving off of a boat, you can have them just inform everybody, hey, we'll be recovering an object. Be aware, right when the object starts to lift, it may rotate or move in a direction that you have not seen coming.
Why haven't they done this with the Titanic? Why haven't they brought it up and put it in a museum?
I don't know.
That is a really good question.
Because you can't even dive it, right?
You can't dive it, it is very deep, but you can have ROVs, you can have saturated divers.
What's an ROV?
It's a remote operated vehicle.
Isn't there some guy that you can pay and go see the Titanic?
Yes, I heard about that.
Is that possible though, because isn't it at like 2,000 feet or something?
You might be able to see it from the surface on a clear day. I do not know much about the Titanic to know, I'm sorry. That's a very good question, I will look it up and have an answer for you. After the
but if we could dive it, there would be like treasure.
There would be. Would it be whatever people left or
there were a lot of rich people on the boat. There'd be jewelry. We can
it
go
would
get
typically
it.
Being...
So you're telling me we can take an ROV after this class to the Titanic?
No, ROV is a completely separate class. So can we please get back on topic and continue with the lecture?
Teacher's getting mad at you, Lauren. You better stop it.
Objects rotation, movement, when lifting.
I heard that was James Cameron who has
I think so.
Excuse me, Jeremy. Topic,
I'm
please.
Sorry. Titanic's really exciting to me.
Well, we can talk about it more after class. Another form of purposely rotating an object is called carbuckling. I don't know why it's called that, but it is. And it's just when you put a line underneath an object and attach it to the opposite side.
Huh, carbuckling.
Mm-hmm.
Never heard of that.
It's a very odd term.
Yeah.
So that's typically used by commercial divers and large salvage. So I just want to inform you of it, but we don't really need to know that for our purposes of this recreational course. And then obviously how the currents will affect boat drift, whatever object you're recovering, how much harder it may be if there is a severe current. So, lifting safety. Safety when you're actually lifting it. Take into consideration the depth, your maximum time at the depth, and how far the object actually has to travel to get up to the surface. Ascending with the object. I don't recommend this, just because the object may end up ascending a lot quicker. As Boyle's law goes into effect, we will go over physics within a few slides. But as the air expands, as it lifts up, the object will ascend much quicker. So I don't recommend ascending with the object. You will completely be ignoring your ascent rate. A tagline is a line that is attached to the object that you hold on to. So to do this, you just want to make sure you don't get tangled, and if it does end up flying too much, you will just let go of the line and just let it go to the surface freely. A free ascent is just that, you just let it go up. If you are doing a free ascent, make sure that the people topside in the boat, or you have somebody topside that is aware of the object coming up. Overfilling lift bags. Some lift bags are open bottom, some are closed bottom. The closed ones, you actually have to worry about the pressure blowing the bag and then falling, and the object falling back down. So while you're lifting, you want to make sure you lift the object up just enough so it gets up off the floor, and maybe a little bit more, it'll start to ascend. You can try to keep up with it and ride the lift bag. and emptying it a little bit as you do to control the ascent rate. But if you do lose it, just let it go. Make sure you're free and clear and get out of the way in case it does fall. Excuse me, Gabrielle. Not paying attention?
I was looking at the dogs, I'm sorry.
And do not stay directly on top or underneath of the object in case it ascends too quickly. You don't want it to hit you. In case it falls back down, you don't want it to land on you.
I got a question. I've heard a lot of books where I've heard of objects getting like sucked into the mud on the bottom if they've been sitting there for a long time. So
yes.
I just won't do anything. How do you do with that?
So the easy way to do with that is to actually dig the object out before you attach lift bags to it. So you actually have to go down with the shovel and dig around the object to make sure that you know how big it is and that it isn't going to be bringing up a whole bunch of sand with it. Because if it does and it pulls all the sand up, right as that sand drops, the object will go flying up to the surface.
Mm-hmm. Are we going to be able to do that? I mean, it sounds dangerous to be digging around something that's big.
You shouldn't be recovering anything larger than, I would say, 50 to 100 pounds. That's outside of recreational limits, and that's typically for archaeological diving and commercial divers.
Isn't it a job in the military to find bombs underwater?
Yes. There are many different kinds of salvage and recovery.
After you take this class, can you apply for that job?
You can apply for that job whenever you want. That's a military job. You can apply to join the military, but you wouldn't be qualified for it, no. So there are special challenges that you may encounter during the dive, things that would make it harder. So ice diving, for example, the object won't actually come up to the surface. It'll end up hitting the ice. You'll have a lot of trouble finding it. And you also have to worry about hypothermia, how long you can stay down without getting too cold. Decompression diving is just that. You want to be aware of what your deco will be and maintain your time down there to a minimum. So you can, if you can, do a no deco dive, that would be great. If you're qualified for a deco dive, you can do that as if you're a tech diver. But be aware of your time. Try to minimize your decompression when you are rigging up the object to lift out. Caves, mines, and caverns. Important thing to remember here is if you are using a lift bag, you have to keep it just neutral so that the bag doesn't hit the ceiling and pop. And if you have to make sure you'll be able to get it out of the cave safely. If there is a squeeze,
Charlotte.
Are we done with the dogs for
yeah.
now? Yes? Alright. If you have to go through a squeeze or a tight spot, that you'll be able to lift to bring the object and the lift bag while still attached out. And then wrecks. Will you end up needing to penetrate the wreck where the object is? Will you be able to exit safely? And will you be damaging the artificial reef in the process? If you're gonna end up damaging the reef, you shouldn't do it. If it's a public wreck that's been recorded, you won't be allowed to recover anything off it. Everything must stay where it is. All right, so now we get to the physics of the recovery. So does everybody remember Boyle's Law?
Boyle's balloons.
That is one way to remember it. Do you know what that means?
Pressure and volume are inversely proportional.
There you go.
P1, V1.
That's the formula for it.
Equals
very good.
P2, V2.
Yes. As pressure goes up, volume goes down, and vice versa. This has to do with the air inside the lift bags that you'll be using. As the lift bag goes up, the air will expand
because
there's less
pressure.
Yeah. All right. Archimedes' principle. This is just stating it's the buoyancy principle. An object's weight in the water is equal to the water it displaces.
Huh.
Do you remember that?
No, I do.
Alright. So this basically is good for calculating the capacity of lift you're going to need while it's in the water. Do you have any questions? Your facial expressions look like you don't quite understand.
Mm-mm. Are we going to do
call her facial expressions, though?
asking any questions.
To be fair, I was
making funny faces.
Okay. So that is used to. Excuse me, sir. Can you please get off your phone?
That's a funny ring.
Yeah. That's...
All right. Can we get back to the task at hand?
Sorry.
All right. So you should calculate the lift capacity of the lift bag and how much and the weight of the object. We can go over some problems after the slideshow. So everybody is aware of objects' weight in water, what they displace, and to calculate how much lift is in it. So as with lift bags, you're always going to want to know, after calculations, you'll know how many lift bags you need, what size of lift bag you need, and the number of cylinders, if that's how you're going to inflate the bag, you need to supply the air. Or you can always have a compressor topside with a really long hose leading down to you. So lifting methods. So there's lift bags, open or bottom. This is one of the lift bags. This is actually an open bottom lift bag. And it's called that because the bottom of the lift bag is open. Okay? So with the lift bags, you would attach it to the object or to the rigging that you have wrapped around it with the clip. And you can fill it up with air from a cylinder you bought down. You shouldn't fill it up with the same cylinder you're breathing off of, because you may end up using up all your air and then you have no air. Everyone has a pull cord on it that actually is attached to a button up top, and when you pull it, it actually deflates the lift bag. So as it ascends, the bag will fill up with more and more air. If it's going too quickly, you can pull this, drain some air out.
Like your BC.
Exactly like your BC. It's just not your buoyancy, it's the object's. The advantage to open bottom lift bags is they're easier to use. You don't need any serious connections like with a closed bottom bag. But if you have too much air in it as it ascends, it will just end up coming out, which could make the bag not as have as much capacity to lift and send the object back down.
So how much would that lift bag lift? About how much?
So most lift bags actually say their lift capacity on them. This one does not.
What would you guess?
My guess would be a 50-pound lift bag.
That's it.
Based on the size. Mm. So when you do buy a lift bag, it'll say how much is on it, and I also recommend just writing the lift pounds on the bag itself. All right. Instead of a bag, you can also use barrels or drums for lifting. But with them, you have to realize that you also have to compensate for the weight of the barrel, and you will have to calculate how much lift you need based on the cubic feet of the barrel itself. So another method is water displacement. This is more used by commercial divers, so I'm just going to touch upon it so you're aware of it. But they actually use a pump to pump the water out to make the object lighter. Another way is by filling the object with air. Say if you had a barrel you wanted to bring up and there's a hole at the bottom, you can just stick, say, an octo in it from the tank you're not breathing off of, fill it up with air, and the object will just go up to the surface. So whenever you are lifting an object with that method, just make sure that there's no holes in it. You don't want the air that you're filling it up with to just come out. So do you have any questions on the methods or the different ways? The primary one will be lift bags. All good? All right. Rigging. So this is how you would attach the lift bag to the object. Tying the proper knots to hold the object to the bags, and making sure that your line is strong enough to hold the object without snapping. These are four basic knots to go over. We will tie some later. And then a quick review of what we went over. Search patterns, equipment, environmental impact, rigging, lifting methods, physics, your challenges, and removing from the water, which we did not quite get to today.